Well, good morning, everybody. Why don't you make your way on in? We're glad to see you this morning here at the Brownstone. We're glad to see growth happening here at the Brownstone. Would you stand and join with us in worship today?
Remember those walls that we called sin and shame, that we couldn't escape. But he came and he died and he rose. Those walls are up now. Remember those giants we called death and grave. They were like mountains that stood in our way. But he came and he died and he rose. Those giants are dead now. Cause this is our God, this is who he is. He loves us. This is our God, this is what he does. He saves us. He bore the cross. That fear that took our breath away, faith so weak that we could barely pray. But he heard every word, every whisper. And now those altars in the wilderness tell the story of his faithfulness. Nobody but Jesus, who rescued me from that grave. Yahweh, Yahweh, who gets the glory and praise. Nobody but Jesus, who rescued me from that grave.
To us, Lord.
I've been held in your hand. From the moment that I wake up until I lay my head, I will sing of the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so close like no other. I've known you as a father, I've known you as a friend, and I have lived in the goodness of God. All my life you have been faithful. All my
your hands and sing it.
All my life you have been faithful. All my life you have been so, so
you're the you, God. How can we not give you praise today, Lord, in this house? Could sing these songs as I often do, but every song must end, and you never do. So I throw up my hands and praise you again and again, 'cause all that I have is a hallelujah. But I've nothing else fit for a king except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. I've got one response. I've got just one wide. I will worship you. So I throw up my hands to praise you again and again. 'Cause all that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've got for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. So come on, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song, 'cause you've got a lion inside of those lungs. Get up and praise the Lord. Oh, come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. Cause all that I have is a hallelujah. but I'm nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah. And when you don't know what to sing,
as you reflect on your week and how God met you in those places. Maybe it was little, maybe it was big, maybe it was his protection, his provision. Whatever it was, as we go to prayer with that mindset of just being grateful, we have nothing else to give the King of Kings but our praise and our love and our devotion. Lord, we worship you. We worship you, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We have nothing to give you except our lives, our worship, and our praise, and our thanksgiving and gratitude to you, Jesus, for all that you are, for all that you have been, and Lord, for who you are going to be in our lives. We stand firm on your word. We stand firm on the foundation. God, we're so grateful. And we sing hallelujah. And we sing praise, Lord. You are worthy. You are holy. And we worship you. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing in our hearts, what you're doing in our lives, what you're doing in our community, in our world. And thank you, Jesus, for what you're doing in the Brownstone Church. Thank you, Jesus. We celebrate the growth and we celebrate the goodness of God in this place today. We are grateful people. We love you, Jesus. In your precious name, amen. Amen. Well, welcome to the 1045. How about that for you all? A little extra 15 minutes to get you here ready to praise the Lord. We're so glad you're with us. Would you greet one another? God bless you. Thank you for being at the Brownstone.
Amen. There you go. It's so good to have you in the 1045 service. We had a great service in the first one. We believe in the Lord is showing up in the second one. Isn't God good? You should say it extra loud because you got the extra 15 minutes of sleep. That's what you got. We said, come on, my soul, get out of bed. That's what we said. We said that early this morning in the middle of the darkness, and all that was fun. So here we are. It's good to see some friends that I haven't seen in a while, some others right here, some new folks. Thank you guys for being with us today. It's an awesome time. If you weren't with us last week, we have a brand new church councilman. Let's see, did I see him somewhere around here earlier today? He just walked that way. These new we put them to work. We make them work immediately. So our new councilman is Jay McCoy, if you weren't part of us. And if you stuck around for part of last week but didn't get to be in the congregational meeting, we have these annual reports as a way of just showing God's faithfulness to us in the last year. This is nothing short of miraculous. You need to get a copy of this. They're on the table out back, and I assure you, you'll see how God has blessed us. We have a couple of other announcements. Let me give those to you. This Thursday, March 28th, ladies' luncheon. It's going to be at Annie's house. As I told the first crowd, Mike, Annie's husband, is going to be working like a dog for about 3 days. And you want to go there and see how that's going to work out. So that's going to be that. March 31st is going to be Easter, coming up in a couple of weeks. So wonderful of a time of the year. I would invite you to invite somebody to Easter service. It's going to be a special service. We're going to have some great things in store for you and children and everything. I would invite your neighbors, invite those you like, invite those you don't like. Invite all of them. Just come and enjoy them. Or maybe you like them all, they just don't like you. Whatever works for you, go from there. Let me tell you, your giving has been nothing short of miraculous in the last 12 months or even since we began this church 7 years ago. And last year we had the privilege of investing some $15,000 into a medical clinic in Kenya. And so I told you guys last week that I'd show you the video from this week. So here you go.
Greetings, brothers and sisters. My name is Sammy Chacha, the National Director of Vital Solutions Kenya, and also the Bishop Elevation Churches of Kenya. I am here in Turkana County to begin a work that you guys, the Brownstone Church back in the U.S., have been a great part to make this happen. I want to be so grateful to the pastor and the congregation for having raised the funds for us to be able to raise this building. As you can see, we are already in the bushes. There's nothing, but out of nothing, something is going to come up. And I want again to say thank you so much for being so generous to these people of the Turkana County. I'm here with their pastor. He's called Pastor Donald Loboko. The members are here. They are anticipating and waiting for this structure to come up. It's going to be a great blessing to this community, their children, mothers, fathers, and everybody that comes in. So thank you again so much for giving into this noble cause. And of course, I want to be grateful to my friend Tessa, who has connected us to this great, great network. And of course, we want to say God bless you. And in a few moments, we are beginning from zero. And then as the days go by, we will get you updated as the structure comes up. Thank you so much again, and God bless you.
Amen. Isn't it wonderful what a few dollars can do? It's amazing just what dollars and cents can do. And your dollars and their cents, it just kind of brought it all together. It just really worked. Isn't that something? Tessa is our missionary. Randy and Tessa Payne are the missionaries over there. Randy teaches at the college, and Tessa is in the medical industry or in the medical field. And so she made us a connection with these guys, so it's wonderful. I'm so excited. We were able to invest almost $90,000 last year in missions, and so it's been a big year for us at Brownstone Church. So thank you for that. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to Psalm 23. Psalm 23. We've been working on a short series now, as I told you guys last week and the last couple of weeks. We've been in the book of Romans for several weeks, and Romans is the meat of the word. That's that deep stuff. But we felt like we needed a sorbet, so we went with a little chocolate cake. We jumped over to Psalm 23, and this is the end of it. This is the cherry on top of the chocolate cake. Got a little whipped cream right there with it, too. Some of y'all getting hungry already. Before we begin, why don't you pray this prayer with me? Say, Lord Jesus, speak to me again. I am listening. The Psalms were written over a period of time, perhaps as much as 600 years. David wrote 73 of the 150 Psalms. His best friend, a guy named Anonymous, wrote 49 of them. That got a better laugh in the first service. I don't know. Now it's all a competition. I get it. I see how this is going to work. Thank you. All right. Now we're on the same team. All right. Here we go. Keep going. And we've been working on Psalm 23 for a while. So let's just go ahead and see. You should have it memorized by now. Here we go. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. We're going to stop right there. We've worked on verses 1 through 3 the first week, verse 4 last week. This week we're going to wrap it up with verses 5 and 6. When I jumped into the middle of this as a series, I thought, I can cover Psalm 23 in 3 weeks. I stretched it out for about 12 because there's like 12 word pictures that David gives us of the Lord. And the shepherd is just one of them, but this is it. So today we're going to jump into this. We're going to wrap it up with these last two verses. So let me break this verse down for you. First off, it says you. That means that you is God himself, the good shepherd. That's great. The second word is prepares. God is the great preparer. Anybody prepare what you're going to wear the next day when you get up in the morning? Nobody in this service? Okay, great. You're just like me. You got up and you said, what's not wrinkled? This is me. This was as good as it got today, or I pulled it out and stretched it a little bit, threw a little something on it. There you go. But we prepare in certain ways, but the fact is God is the greatest preparer ever that you will face. He's been preparing things. And let me give you a couple of examples. Over in Exodus, when God got ready to send Moses and the children of Israel into the promised land, he said this, "Behold, I send an angel before you to guard you on the way and to bring you to the place that I have prepared." He prepared it for them. And then Jesus, when he was speaking about, he was giving them a parable over in Matthew. He said, "Then the king will say to those on his right," and this king, as he's talking about, is God, "Come, you who are blessed by my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world." That means that God's been preparing a long, long time. And then a little bit later in that, he talks about those that haven't accepted him, what their preparation is going to be like. He finds it in verse 41. "Then he will say to those on the left, depart from me, you cursed, into the eternal fire, prepared for the devil and his angels." So God prepared something for saints, and he prepared something for the devil and his angels. And unfortunately, those that don't know the Lord are going to wind up in that same place. And then over in John chapter 14, Jesus said it like this, "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you, so that I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." And then one of the greatest verses found in the Bible is 1 Corinthians 9, or 2 and 9. "No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him." God is such a preparer. He has prepared some stuff for you today. He has prepared this for you. He has prepared a meal for all of us today. He is such a preparer. Thirdly, the word table. Now, that doesn't just mean table. That means the king's table. It comes from a Hebrew word that means the king's table. It's a banquet table. It's not mac and cheese or ramen noodles in the microwave. It's the real deal. I think we can all agree there's a difference between Taco Casa and Del Frisco Steakhouse. Everybody? Now, I like them both. I eat them both regularly. Tacos probably more often than steak. I don't know that it's better for me, but it's definitely cheaper. It happens to be the closest restaurant we have to this current location. So there's the smell of tacos. I'm getting kind of hungry. Let's keep going. Banquet is special. It's important. And best of all, this banquet is for you. It's for me. You are the guest of honor. Everything that you love is on that table. Your favorite foods, even the ones you don't know you like, are on that table. It's like going to mama's house at Thanksgiving. Everything is there. When we have Thanksgiving at our house, we always have very similar things. Why? Because we love them. How many of y'all agree with me? Thanksgiving is no time to try something new. You want the stuff that you know, right? We're like, well, we'll try a couple of things new, but that could ruin the whole meal right there in itself. You get that funky taste in your mouth, you know. You don't. I got off my script there. You're the guest of honor. Have you ever gone to a really nice banquet and as you left, you thought, man, I got to up my game a little bit. Next time I get home, we're going to have to do something different. Because sometimes you go to a place and they just have everything figured out so well. They have the candles that are perfect. They're glowing, you know. They have the flowers just right. And then you sit down and your napkin is folded in some kind of crazy origami sort of something or other that you don't know whether to take it home or to wipe your mouth with it. I mean, it's just that's that kind of thing, because everything is so special. It's so great. It's wonderful. There it is right in front of you. Let me tell you something about God. He's the king of hospitality. He was lighting candles and making floral arrangements and folding little napkins into shapes long before anybody else was, because he's the king of hospitality. He knows what you like. When he prepares a banquet before you, he knows what you like. You're the guest of honor, and he's going to come prepared for you. He's been preparing a long time, and he knows you very well. Now, here's the twist. It doesn't just say that he prepares a banquet for me. It says that he prepares a banquet for me in the presence of my enemies. In the presence of my enemies. That means it's a public display. He wants the whole world to witness this event. He loves you that much. But there's an even more interesting thing about the public display. It says it's in front of our enemies. That means that it's on a battlefield. That means that this banquet isn't just when everything is going good in your life. It's even when things are going bad and you're under attack. God is going to say to you, He is saying to you, I'm going to come to you in the middle of your battle. I'm going to honor you. I'm going to fellowship with you. I'm going to encourage you. I'm going to eat with you. And there's nothing your enemies can do but watch. Now, who are my enemies? Well, you got three of them. First off, the world. Second, the devil. Third, the flesh. The world is that culture that you live in. If you haven't noticed recently, the culture that you live in is diametrically opposed to what you believe in. If you've ever been put down or criticized by the way that you worship or who you worship and all of that, if you've ever been talked down to or been the subject of somebody's insults because of your faith, that's simply the culture around you trying to shape you and mold you into their image instead of you being in the image of Christ. They don't like that. They don't like who you are. Have you ever noticed that the Holy Spirit in you irritates the devil and some other people? It happens. The Holy Spirit inside you, you can just walk into a room sometime and other people are like, nah, and they just get that, they get that funky look on their face, that crazy look, because why? It's the God in you that irritates the devil in them. And that's what happens with the culture. You get around some people, that's the culture. The next enemy you have is Satan or the devil. Jesus said in John 10:10, the thief, that is Satan, comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants to steal your peace. He wants to kill your dreams. He wants to destroy your life. The reason that Satan wants to destroy you isn't because he's just concerned about you or cares about you or is worried about what you're going to do. The number one reason that Satan wants to destroy you, kill you, and bring about all of this havoc on you is because he knows that God himself is in love with you. You are the apple of God's eye. The best way to get at me is to get at me through my kids. You as a parent know that when somebody messes with your children, then they're going to have to answer to you. And Satan understands sometimes how he believes that if he can get to us, he can get to the Father. Let me tell you this, that's just the way the enemy thinks. The third enemy is probably the biggest one of all, and that's the old nature that you have inside of you. You don't always do the right things. You don't always think the right things. You don't always speak the right things. Have you ever done that? Have you ever noticed that? I think I'm talking to the right crowd when I say what Paul said over in the whole chapter in the book of Romans, Romans chapter 7, when he says, I don't want to do what is wrong, but I do it anyway. King James Version puts it like this. He says, the things that I don't want to do are the things that I do, and the things that I do are the things that I don't want to do. Oh, wretched man that I am. This was Paul talking, and I think we can all agree with that. There are times when something flies out of our mouth, and we think, why did I say that? Or why did I do that? Or why did I act like that? Or why did I think that? And that's just the old nature. It's the flesh within us, and it is an enemy of us. Another thing that banquets represent in the Bible is fellowship. I like what Psalm 5 from the Message says, 5 and verse 11. But you'll welcome us with open arms when we run for cover to you. Let the party last all night. Stand guard over our celebration. Two songs come to mind when I read that verse. There's a party going on right here. Some of y'all, and all night long. I mean, so it's kind of a Lionel Richie. So these are the things that... Now, I see where y'all been listening to. A little too much MTV right there. That's what that is. God is saying, I know you're in a battle, but I want to throw a banquet for you anyway so you'll be encouraged, rested, and restored, and then you can get back to the battle all prepared. It's like God is saying, come over here and rest a while, and you just stay right here. I'll let the guys beat the dents out of your armor, or somebody can come over there and polish up your sword. And I mean, we can get you all ready, get you rested, so that when you get back in battle, you can come walking out there on the battlefield like, well, I'm here now, and I'm looking good. You know, I'm ready to go. Everything is ready. God is prepared that. And the enemy is simply looking up at what's going on, scratching his head, and said, why is there a big banner on that tent up there with that big long table that says, I love you, Steve. Signed, Jesus, the King. See, that's kind of the way this all looks. That's kind of the way this plays out in your life. You've got the King of Kings inviting you to a banquet table in just your honor, and God himself is showing up. Joseph was having the worst battle of his life when he heard these words in Job was having the worst battle of his life when he heard these words over in Job 36. And at this very moment, God deeply desires to lead you from trouble and to spread your table with your favorite food. Isn't it wonderful that we serve a God who knows what we like, who knows what we need? Banquets in the Bible also represent food. God wants to hang out with you, but he also wants to feed you. He knows that if you're starving, you're not going to be effective in battle, and so he wants you to eat. And that's where the Word of God comes from. This is spiritual food. And God is going to bless you in front of a watching world. Psalm 31:19 puts it like this. How great is the goodness you have stored up for those who fear you. Stored up indicates advanced planning. He says, you lavish it on those who come to you for protection, blessing them before the watching world. Go ahead and let the world watch. The world is watching. They're watching how God blesses your life. They're watching how you respond to how God blesses your life. The world is watching how you respond when good things happen and when bad things happen. We are a testimony. You're a testimony in any situation, in any season that you're going through. You are a testimony to the world. They are watching. And because God has already prepared what he has in store for you, that simply means that even in the battle that you're currently going through, God has already prepared the victory celebration that's going to come after that battle. Isn't that wonderful? So here's a question. What's on the menu? When I go eat somewhere, I want to know what's on the menu. Now, sometimes I go to the same restaurants over and over again. They don't need to bring me a menu. I know what I like. I'll take the number 5. I kind of know what's that's Antonio's, by the way. And there'd be a lot of references on this thing. Number 5, that's 2 enchiladas and queso on top of that. That's awesome. I had that last night. And here we go. Where are we at? Here's the question. Have I already said that, or this is a new service? Okay, there we go. The answer to what's on the menu is everything that's in the Word of God. Everything. Scripture, there's some 5,500 promises in this book. 5,500, that's a lot. And if there's 5,500 promises in this, why are so many of the people that you know just eating a little bit? Why are we so interested in eating internet granola bar? social media sushi? Why do we spend so much time with that instead of the Word of God that's right here? This is the good stuff. Why do we spend all of our time eating the little snacks, things that don't have any depth, don't have any calories, don't have any that aren't going to build us up? You can have a feast anywhere you have a Bible. Most of us have smartphones, so we can pull our phone out, and you can start eating anytime you want to right there on the Bible app. And here's the other thing. Don't go to the banquet just once a week. You'll starve to death. Nobody just eats once a week. That's not how you stay healthy. Psalm 34:8 puts it like this. Learn how to savor how good the Lord is. Are you savoring the words of God? And you think, well, maybe I am, maybe I'm not. Pastor Steve, there's some things on this that I don't understand. I have a hard time reading it because there's some things I don't understand. Well, let me ask you first off, are you reading out of a version that sounds more like they spoke 1,000 years ago? Or are you reading something you can understand? So sometimes it's just the translation that you're reading, and I would say find something you can understand. If you can't understand it, you won't read it. The other thing I would tell you is that how you look at this Bible will determine what you think of this Bible will determine how you read it or if you read it. If you think it's a law book, you won't read it. Most of us don't sit around and think, well, I'd like to read something exciting. I'm going to read some law books. We don't read law books. That's not it. If you look at it as a textbook, you're probably not going to read it. When I got out of school, I put the textbooks away. I was once a child, and I thought like a child. You know, there's that. But I don't normally read textbooks unless I was in school. And then some of you look at it just as an old history book. Now, I happen to be one of those people that like history, and the Bible is filled with great historical stories, but it's not just a history book. Some of you look at this like it's an insurance policy. I don't sit around reading insurance policies. Just show me where to sign. But some people look at this as an insurance policy. This is my get-out-of-hell insurance policy right here. That's what this is. This is an insurance policy. So you would look at that like that. But if any of those things, if you're going to think of the Bible as any of those things, more than likely, you're not going to read it. You know why you're not going to read it? Because that's not what the Bible is. This is a love letter written from God to his children. You, This is love. Now, I'm going to talk to the millennials and the Gen Xers and all of those people that don't understand what that is. Many years ago, in a land far away, people used to write what we called letters. If you look on your internet thing and it has that little square up there with a little triangle on the top, that's what they used to have. It looked like an envelope. You would write your letter on pen and parchment or paper, and you would sign it, and then you would put it in an envelope, and you would lick a stamp and stick it right there on the right-hand corner, and that would head off, and in a few days, they would get it. And if you were a soldier, say, in 1910 on the other side of the world, and your girl back home wrote you one of those letters, and they had the mail call, and you got your letter, the first thing you did is you took that letter, and you smelled it. It didn't smell like war. It smelled like her. And then you read that letter. Then you read that letter again. Then you read between the lines. And it was so good. And that's the way love letters are. You just hang on to them. You don't just say, well, throw it over there on the pile and I'll get to it later. That was an important letter that you read. It was a love letter to you. And that's what this is. This is a love letter to you. Have you ever met people that say, well, I tried reading the Bible? You know, people that don't know the Lord and unbelievers, and they don't believe, they think the Bible is just full of old stuff. They say, I didn't get anything out of the letter. It's because you're reading somebody else's mail. If this letter is to you, it's been mailed to you, then this is a love letter to you. Now, can God take your love letter and inspire somebody else? Yes, he has. He's done that multiple times when somebody that doesn't know the Lord begins to sit down and read the words of God, and they come into it with an open mind and an open heart, and they begin to see that God begins to speak through them, and God has changed many a person's life because they have simply begun to read that. But that's what this is. Look at it as a love letter and let God speak to you through the love letter. You want to meet God, the best way you can do is start reading your Bible. Start this week. Begin with the book of Luke. If you want to know something about Jesus, read the book of Luke. It's the life story of Jesus. It'll help you. Start right there if you don't read anything else. Then we come to the next part of that verse, and it says, you anoint my head with oil. Now, what is anointing? Well, that depends on who's doing the anointing. If your neighbor comes to you and anoints you with oil and says, you are now the king of hip-hop, guess what? You are not. Because they don't have the authority, and you can't rap. It all depends on who is doing the anointing, right? It's all about who is doing the anointing. Let me give you a definition for God's anointing. God's got the authority, so here you go. Thank you. When the Holy Spirit supernaturally gives you insight, ability, stamina, authority, or protection that you don't normally have in order to do a job that God has chosen for you to do. There are going to be times in your life where you're in over your head. You don't know what to say next. You don't know what to do next. You don't know what. You're not prepared. You're not qualified for something. Have you ever been involved in something that you aren't qualified for or that you feel inadequate for? I stand before you as Exhibit A. This is kind of what happens sometimes. You get in the middle of stuff where you are over your head and you are swimming as fast as you can to try to do it. You're treading water, and all of a sudden, at just the right time, the Holy Spirit comes in and gives you a word that you had no idea that it was in there, and the Holy Spirit anoints you, and something comes out of your mouth, and you stand back later and you go, what was that? And it's the Holy Spirit working through you and giving you just the right words to say at just the right time. And the anointing of God is flowing through you, and you see power from God flowing through you, and you become just a vessel that God uses. He'll do that for you because that's what the anointing is. Now, it can be inward or it can be outward. When it's an outward anointing by someone, it represents an inward work in a person's life, very much like water baptism is. Water baptism is an outward expression of what's happened on the inside of a person. That just tells the world this person has had a life change on the inside of them. One example is found over in the book of 1 Samuel, when Samuel the prophet anoints Saul to be the first king of Israel. Now Saul wasn't very sharp tool. He wasn't the sharpest tool in the shed. He was the biggest, but he wasn't the sharpest. He was head and shoulders taller than everybody in the nation, but he wasn't prepared mentally or emotionally or spiritually for what God had for him to do, which was become the king of Israel. And so Samuel anoints him with oil, and then he tells him what's going to happen in the next day. He says, you're going to come in contact with some prophets, and they're going to be prophesying. Verse 6 says it like this: at that time, the Spirit of the Lord will come powerfully upon you, and you will prophesy with them, and you will be changed into a different person. A different person. That's what the Holy Spirit, that's what anointing does for you. It changes you into something different. It makes you better than you really are. I have led worship with the anointing, and I've led worship without the anointing. Thank you. That was not the anointing. I've been there when I have seen God's hand upon me in moments in God's hand. You know how I learned how to play the piano? I believe the anointing of God helped me. When I was 11 years old, we lived in a little town, and we moved to a new church and had a small group of people, and we didn't have a piano player. And my dad said, well, son, you know that one song, I guess you'll be the church piano player. Nothing makes you practice like being humiliated in front of 100 people every week. And so at the age of 11, I started playing the piano. Now everything sounded pretty much the same. I had those three chords mastered. And everything was kind of, it all had basically the same groove. And there wasn't a whole lot of excitement in it. But I remember just times where right in the middle of a live experience, I just was young and dumb enough and brave enough and silly enough or whatever to try something. And right in the middle of playing, all of a sudden, I would just get the urge to try something. And when I tried it, sometimes it just worked. And sometimes it didn't. But let's not talk about that. Let's talk about the times it did work. Okay, so the times it did work, I just felt like the Holy Spirit came and just kind of taught me some stuff. Taught me. One of my favorite musicians of all time was a guy by the name of Andre Crouch. Andre Crouch wrote some wonderful songs back in the 70s, and the very first song he wrote was called The Blood Will Never Lose Its Power. He was 14 years old. He just learned how to, and he was self-taught. His father just said, we're going to pray that the Lord gives you the gift of music, and they just laid hands on him, and he said he went to the keyboard and went to the piano and just started playing, and all of a sudden, God just began to teach him what to do, and the anointing came upon him and did that. Some of you are thinking, well, I'm going to pray for the anointing because I want to learn to play the piano. Hey, it can happen. If that's what God has in store for you, if that's what God's purpose for your life is, if that's what you need to do. The other thing, you have to be willing to be embarrassed because that's going to happen too, because sometimes that's what you need. Now, in the Old Testament, and once Saul became anointed, he became more confident, he became bold, he had wisdom that he hadn't had before, he became all of those things that he needed to take on that role as the king of Israel. The anointing will change you. In the Old Testament, there were three kinds of people who were anointed: priests, prophets, and kings. Priests did the anointing in the Old Testament, but when Jesus died on the cross in the New Testament, things changed. Now every believer is a priest. It's called the priesthood of the believers, and now every believer has the authority to anoint with oil other people. Isn't that wonderful? Now, to understand what it means to be anointed by God, you need to look at the basics. First off, you were created with a calling on your life. You were created with a purpose, a plan. God didn't make mistakes when he made you. You were created on purpose, with a purpose, and for a purpose. That purpose may be any number of things. Some have been called to be pastors, evangelists, missionaries, but here's the problem. Many people think that the only people called are pastors, missionaries, those kind of people, ministry people. No, God calls missionaries, and that's wonderful, but God calls businessmen too. Maybe you've been called to be a teacher, a doctor, a carpenter, a businessman, a banker, a plumber, electrician, engineer, policeman, whatever it is that you're in your role right now. If God called you there, he's got a purpose for you to be there. And God will do amazing things through you at just the right time. You will be more fulfilled when you find that calling. So don't ever underestimate the power of your purpose and your calling. He wants you to succeed in your calling. And so you're only going to succeed in your calling when the anointing comes upon you. He will anoint you to be the very best at whatever it is. If you're a carpenter, you're going to be the very best carpenter ever. If you're a painter, you're going to be the very best painter. You're going to be, lines are going to be straighter. You're going to have a steady hand. You're going to be able to spray things just right. Everybody else is going to be high on fumes, and you're just going to be high on Jesus. That's going to be just, it's going to be, That whatever it is, whatever you are, and I believe it's a seasonal thing. Sometimes God anoints you for a certain season. So maybe the season you're in right now, you go, this is not my lifelong purpose. Well, maybe it's not, but maybe it is for right now. You can learn some things from where you are right now. Go ahead and let God anoint you to do that regardless of what you think you need to do. If you think you're good now, wait till the anointing comes. You'll get that much better. Some of you may not even realize that the name of Jesus Christ is not his first and last name. His name's not Jesus, and his last name is not Christ. It's Jesus, and Christ is simply the Greek word that means the anointed one. Jesus is the anointed one. Now, that's in the New Testament. He was the anointed one. But in the Old Testament, the New Testament, the anointed one, Christ is Greek. In the Old Testament, it was Hebrew. What's the Hebrew word for the anointed one? Messiah. Christ and Messiah, same word, two different languages. Anointed. Jesus was anointed. The thing about anointing is that God doesn't anoint you just to bless you, but so that you'll be a blessing to others. The very first sermon Jesus ever preached was in his hometown. He goes into the temple. He walks over and picks up a scroll. He's in Nazareth, and he reads from Isaiah chapter 16. We read it about it in Luke 4. This is what it says. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim that captives will be released, that the blind will see, that the oppressed will be set free, and that the time of the Lord's favor has come. Then it says Jesus rolled up the scroll, put it up, went and sat down and said, today, that verse has been fulfilled in me. He knew that he was anointed. When you know you're anointed, it changes you. You won't be afraid. When you walk into certain situations, you won't be worried that you're not going to have the words to say. Jesus told the disciples that when you go into places and stand before kings and all this, don't worry about what you say. The Holy Spirit will speak through you. How is that possible? The anointing. The anointing will give you the words to say when you need to say it at just the right time. That's the benefit of the anointing. Whatever God has called you to do, you need to know that. We still... Here's one thing to know about the anointing. You need a fresh anointing. You need a daily anointing because it leaks out of us. It doesn't stay with us. If you're living on anointing, I was anointed once back in 1993, and I felt the quiver in my liver, and good things happen, and it was awesome, and, you know, great things. And if you're living on that, and that's the last experience you had, you might be time for something new. Some fresh anointing, some fresh oil in your life. That's it. Everybody needs an oil change every now and then, right? That's it. You need some fresh anointing in your life. So that's important. Don't live off of yesterday's anointing. It won't be enough for tomorrow's battle. Last thing about anointing. We still anoint with oil today. I had anointing oil here. Did it fall? We're going to give you the opportunity. Ah, there it is. I'm a magician. At the end of the service, we're going to have an opportunity. If you need somebody to pray for you, we still anoint with oil. Why do we still anoint with oil? Because it still means something. James chapter 5, verse 14. If you're sick, call for the church leaders. Have them pray for you and anoint you with olive oil in the name of the Lord. Prayers offered in faith will save those who are sick, and the Lord will cure them. Isn't that something? It's not the oil. It's not the oil that cures people. If it was the oil, that we'd just put it on airplanes and drop it on people. That's not it. It's not this. It's not the oil. It's what it represents, and it's the prayer of faith. You anoint with oil with the prayer of faith, and it's the prayer of faith that will raise you up. That's important. Then we come to the next passage. My cup overflows. My cup overflows. What's the cup? Well, the cup is your life. Your life is the cup. Verse 1 says, I have all that I need. Now we've gone to verse 5, and it says, I have more than I need. I thank the Lord that he's not just the God of enough. He's the God of more than enough. That's the difference between being in the wilderness and being in the promised land. You see, when the children of Israel lived in the wilderness, they were living in the land of not enough. When they got over into the land of the promise, they lived in the land of more than enough. How many of you would rather live in the land of more than enough? Yes, we all do. You see, you either have a shortage mentality or you have a surplus mentality. When you live a life where you have a shortage mentality, you're constantly thinking, where's my next dollar coming from? What's next? How can I have enough? And you're always wondering about that. You're afraid of not having enough. When you have a surplus mentality, you're living in an overflowing life because you know that God has enough for everybody. How many of you today, when you took that last breath of air, were worried that there wasn't enough air in the room for everybody? No, we realize there's enough air for everybody. Everybody's gets enough air. You have a God that's got an unlimited supply of whatever we need. Here's the definition of an overflowing life: to be filled beyond capacity with an endless supply of God's goodness. An endless supply of God's goodness. I think that's wonderful. John 10:10. I came that you may have and enjoy life and have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. So how does that happen? Well, we find that over in Isaiah chapter 48. I am the holy Lord God, the one who rescues you for your own good. I teach you and I lead you along the right path. How I wish that you had obeyed my commands. Your success and good fortune would then have overflowed like a flooding river. He was telling these folks that this is what would have happened if they had obeyed. You see, every promise has a premise, and this one does too. There's stipulations on how you have an overflowing life. It's because you have to have an obedient life. You want to have an obedient life? One of the greatest ways to have an obedient life is to meditate on the Word of God. Now, I'm not talking about meditating Eastern meditation where you're sitting in the lotus position and contemplating the lint in your navel. It's nothing like that. You're just constantly and emptying yourself of everything. No, that's Eastern meditation. Meditation from God's way is when you're meditating on the Word of God. You're not emptying yourself. You're filling yourself. And you're mulling things over. Now, let me ask you a question. How many of you know how to worry? Uh-huh. Yeah, we all know how to worry. I see those hands. I see that hand. Well, here's what worry is. Worry is when you take something and you just mull it over and over and over in your mind. If you're good at worrying, you're going to be great at meditating because you've already got the concept down. You already know the concept. You already know what you're doing. You just need to, you got your tords off, as we say in golf. I tee up and I often get my tords off, you know. I was aiming over here and it went over there. That's the way it is with worry and with meditation. If you'll begin to meditate on the good things, think on the good things, think on the things that God wants you to think about and fill your mind with good things. I think that's the prayer that my dad taught me to pray when I preach. Lord, fill my mouth with worthwhile stuff and nudge me when I've said enough. That was his philosophy. Hadn't stuck so much here yet. There's another great thing about this. As I said, some of you guys are going to be pros at meditation. You just don't realize it. So start meditating on the Word. Here's another famous verse that speaks to us about obedience and overflow. Malachi 3:10. Bring the whole tithe into the storehouse so that there may be food in my house. And test me now in this, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open for you the windows of heaven and pour out for you a blessing until it overflows. There's only one verse in the Bible that says that we're to test God about anything. This is it. This is the verse. Test him. He didn't say, test me about your health, jump off of a building somewhere and see if I won't heal your broken leg. That does not exist in the Bible. But this one does. And he says, test me with your money. Amazing. Test me and see if I won't pour out a blessing until it overflows. Yeah, it's a great promise, but you need to test him and see if he's telling the truth. And that brings us to verse 6. Verse 6 says, surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life. We sang about it. It's easy to sing about it. It's easy to get excited about it. It's easy to jump and dance a little bit about it because we like the fact that goodness and mercy are following us all the days of our life. You see, Psalm 145 says the Lord watches over all who love him. Did you know there's never been a moment in your life that God wasn't watching over you? Well, what does that mean? They will follow me. Are they stalking me? No. Does that mean only good stuff's going to happen to me? No. But God will make sure that even in the bad times, something good will come out of it. Are you sure about that? Mm-hmm. Romans 8:28. And we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. Now, did it say that God will work good out of every bad situation for everybody? No, just those that love Him and are called according to His purpose. And if you don't love God, guess what's going to come out of bad? More bad. But if you love God, even in the bad times, good will come out of it. See, good, anybody can bring good out of good, but God can bring good out of bad. That's kind of His specialty. He's the only one that can do that. While goodness is working around me, grace is working in me. Mercy is grace in action. Isaiah 60 and 10, I will have mercy on you through my grace. Now, there's a difference between goodness and mercy. Goodness, I like this definition, is when God gives me what I don't deserve. I expect a C, but I get a B. That's goodness. I expect a 3% raise, and I get a 7% raise. That's goodness. I expected to have twins, and I had triplets, and that's a houseful. Now, mercy, God doesn't give me what I, is when God doesn't give me what I do deserve. You deserve a speeding ticket. But you got a warning. That's mercy. You deserve punishment or penalty, but you get off. That's mercy. You deserve death, but you had life instead. That's mercy. Because God is a good God, I can expect His provision and His pardon. Provision, He gives me good things. Pardon, He forgives all the bad things in my life. I'm glad that it doesn't say His justice will follow me all the days of my life. How many of you are thankful that you don't have justice? Justice is what we deserve, and God's like, I'm following you. I'm going to make sure you... I'd rather have mercy any day than justice. Don't give me justice, God. Give me mercy. Let me give you an illustration. I like this illustration about goodness and mercy. Now, God does this in a lot of ways. I think sometimes I think of it as the way that He blesses us in goodness and mercy. One way He does it, I think, is through even angels. The Bible says He'll give His angels charge over you. And you're saying, Pastor Steve, are my angels called goodness and mercy? No, I don't know what your angels are called. Mine are Bubba and Vincent or Leroy. I think Leroy. Leroy is a better name. We don't know. We don't know what angels are named. And you know, that's not really this. But I think sometimes God uses a variety of circumstances to bless us and to help us with the goodness and the mercy. But I think one great illustration is how sheep are treated. So you drive cattle and from the rear, but from sheep you lead them from the front. And the sheep follow you, but shepherds often have sheepdogs. Where are sheepdogs? Back there with the sheep. Behind the sheep, following them. You got goodness on one side and mercy on the other. Scout and sailor right back there behind them. That's right, see? It's the two at our house. And they're running along, just kind of keeping the sheep together, making sure that the sheep aren't wandering off, falling in a ravine, running away from the herd. They're just there to kind of keep track of it. They're following to make sure. They're guarding the rear. They're making sure no wild things come and take people away. You know, there's a lot of wild things out there that are coming to get you in trouble. Wild things don't just make your heart sing. That didn't show up in the first service either. I don't know where that comes from. And then Psalm 23 and 6, the last verse. And I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Could there be a more ultimate understatement in the Word of God? He has just given us 11 things that are 12 word pictures of the goodness of God and how good God is. This is not about our faithfulness to God. This is all about His faithfulness to us. Is there anything? And if that's not enough, He follows it up with, and oh, by the way, you're going to live with me forever. Yeah. Even if things are bad, even if sometimes the battle gets a little hot, even if there's some things in your life that you just don't understand, even if there's some difficult trials and things where you say, God, I don't understand what's going on. I don't know what's happening. Lord, this is not the way I planned it at all. God is saying, I'm with you always. And by the way, when it's all said and done, you're going to come to my house. You're going to come to live with me. To the place that I have prepared, and I have been preparing, and it's perfect. It doesn't get any better than this. Your wildest imaginations can't even understand what it is. Here's the verse that we used earlier, Romans or 1 Corinthians 2 and 9. No eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has imagined what God has prepared for those who love him. He has prepared heaven for you because he loves you. I'm going to invite you to bow your heads right now. The goodness of God is not an accident. He didn't think about it after the fact. It's in his nature to be good to you. It's in his nature to love you. He created you with one purpose in mind. He wanted to fellowship with you. He wanted you to know from the beginning that you were special in his eyes. You were the apple of his eye. You were a God. He was a God that fell in love with you even before he created you. He fell in love with the idea of you before you were manifested as the person that you are right now. He loves you that much, and he's prepared good things for you. The Word of God says, no weapon formed against you will prosper. Every tongue that rises against you will be silenced. I think that's for somebody here today. You're going through something, and you have felt like there's just some, you're hearing voices, you're hearing words that are coming into your mind and trying to tell you that you're not worthy and that you'll not amount to anything. And God is saying for you today, I got a plan for you. My plan is so much better for you than you can imagine. You just think you know what's best for you, but I really know what's best for you. And goodness and my mercy are going to follow you all the days of your life, not just occasionally, but all the days of your life. If you're here today and you'd say, Pastor Steve, I have not always followed the Lord as faithfully as I should, but I want to give him my heart today. I want to ask him to come into my life and be my Savior today. This is your opportunity. This is a personal thing. It's very private. It's just between you and God. Nobody's looking around. It's just me and you and God. And God's more important than I am. But if you're here today and you'd say, Pastor Steve, I'd like to accept Jesus, I'd like you to raise your hand right where you are today. And we're going to pray. Thank you. Thank you. Now, church, can we just pray this prayer? Say, Lord Jesus, come into my heart. Wash me of all my sin. Clean me from the inside out. I choose to follow you all the days of my life. From now on, I will follow you just like goodness and mercy are following me. Today, Lord, I accept you as Lord. I believe that you died and that you rose again to prove that you are who you said you are. I accept you as my Lord today. In Jesus' name, amen. Now, after the close of service today, we're going to have some teams down front. If you need prayer about anything, they're going to be here and they're going to give you an opportunity for you to be anointed and prayed over. The prayer of faith shall raise up those who are sick, and anything else you've got going on. You may be sick physically, you may be sick financially, emotionally, relationally, whatever it is, we've got some folks that are going to come and be ready. So I'm going to invite you to stand with us this morning. Thank you so much for being here on this first Sunday of two services. You look around, see the size of this crowd. The first one was bigger. Next week, those people may decide to sleep in, and this one will be bigger. We never know. This has been awesome, but it's been a great day to be with you. I'm so grateful that you're here. Hold your hands out. We're going to speak a blessing over you right now. Now may the Lord bless you as he prepares a table before you. May the world watch as he blesses you even in the middle of the battle. May provision and pardon be yours as goodness and mercy follow you. May your life overflow abundantly as the promises of God are fulfilled. And may the anointing on your life cause you to excel far beyond your wildest expectations into whatever God has called you to do. Have a great week, everybody. See you next Sunday.